entirely from the.
Yeah, so.
Don't make any support.
Who's that?
We all had our times. You judges are always at me. We were this guy.
Oh, I'm going to read all these.
God.
Just being recorded.
You know I'm nice to you.
You are. Very nice.
Thank you.
With sponsor.
I mean, even if it is an Elvis wedding, it's still in the bride room.
No, no, you're going.
Hi.
Mom has it, Dad.
Making a popular is one game.
You want to make it an 88, get used to it. That's what we do, have your oatmeal.
Yeah.
Prune juice.
Yeah.
Some green tea.
Yeah.
And you're all set.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Christopher Ianella. I will chair the hearing this morning. First of all, I'd like to read a letter dated December 7th, addressed to the Executive Council. Dear Councilors, I'm pleased to nominate James Byrne to the position of Associate Justice of the Chelsea District Court. Sincerely, Charles Baker, Governor. At this point, I'd like to introduce Councilor Juvenville. Other councilors will be on the way. I understand there's a lot of traffic today. And I know you have a lot of distinguished guests, so we'll hear from them first. First, we'll hear from the Honorable Thomas Drescher, Associate. We're going to go out. We want
to. No,
he'll be on. Thomas Drescher, Associate Justice of the Superior Court.
Good morning, councilors. I'm here on behalf of my good friend, Jim Byrne. We practiced together for almost 30 years, and for most of that time, we were partners in the traditional sense. But we were together in that practice for almost 30 years before I got finished. Running a law practice together, as you know, is a challenge. Running any business is a challenge. And the fact that we remain partners and friends for all that period of time, I think, is self-evident of how much trust and faith I have in his legal, his integrity, his honesty, his legal skills, and his work ethic. A lot of relationships, business or otherwise, don't last that long. We last a long time. What makes a good business partner? I would say trust in each other's honesty and integrity. Trust that the work ethic and effort, dedication to the practice is equal to yours, because it doesn't work as partners if you're not both working at the same pace and both confident that you're putting in the same effort. Trust that the talent and ability is equal to yours, because whenever your partner or any of your employees or people from your office do something or present themselves in court, it's a reflection on you. And I was always confident that Jim was fulfilling his relationship with me as a partner in those three respects. And I like to think that we had a good practice when we were together, as Jim still does, and that we were, every time I appeared, I reflected well on him. Every time he appeared, he reflected well on me. And those are the things that I had with Jim for so many years. There was never a concern for honesty or integrity between the two of us. There was never a concern for diligence. There was never a concern for legal skills. He was, I can't ask for any better as a law partner and as a lawyer. And some of the other things I just want to mention is Jim has a great sense. He's a very creative person. These are all qualities, I think, that will help him as a judge. He's creative. He would see theories in cases that I would never see sometimes. I would sit down and review a file that he might have been involved in and just say, why didn't I think of that? And that was that's again a foundation for a partnership where you're each helping each other as opposed to one person thinking of everything. No, in Jim's case, creativity was his hallmark. Common sense, if I had to give one, cite one quality, I reviewed, worked on, consulted with Jim on hundreds of cases over the course of time, and I have to say, of all the lawyers I worked with, and I worked with some outstanding ones, his the quality of his work was top shelf. I knew that any time I picked up a file, it was going to be perfectly organized, great legal strategy, thought, and no stone left unturned. His results exceeded my expectations, often to my benefit. He has common sense, a unique ability to get to the core, the essence of the matter, great interpersonal skills with witnesses, clients, people from all backgrounds. He speaks directly, honestly, realistically, and tactfully to everyone. His community activism, his wonderful family are self-evident of the fact that he's well-respected by others beyond the legal field. He always had the best ability that I've ever seen to size up a case and assess what would the average person, what would the normal person think of this case. And at the end of the day, when we're presenting cases to juries, that's the most important thing. I think that the bottom line is he has a great sense of fairness and justice. And as a judge, he'll become a partner in the legal system. And I think he'll be a great partner for the Commonwealth, for the judicial system. And he has all the great qualities to be one of the great judges that you'll ever approve. And I ask you to vote favor.
Thank you very much. Okay. When I heard you, excuse me, when I was listening to you, I was thinking of my law partner, you know, Tom Rumble.
Yes.
We together for 35
years. There you go.
Great
relationship. And that's
all
I could do.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next we'll hear from Christopher Hughes, Associate Justice of the Superior Court. What I'd like to introduce Counselor Terry Kennedy.
Counselor, sorry I'm late. I was up late last night.
Jim, I wasn't. Counselors, good morning. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak on behalf of that Byrne. It is always a pleasure to appear before you. It's not quite as pleasurable as it was 16 years ago when you confirmed my nomination to the Superior Court. So again, I want to thank you and the collective body for that. I first met Jim Byrne when he was a senior at Boston Latin School, and I had just begun a seven-year career teaching in Boston Public Schools. He was known as Bunzo, a name that carried through Harvard College, Suffolk Law School, the Boston City Council, and throughout an illustrious legal career. He was always a very good student.
Surprisingly, children.
He was always a very good student and accomplished in so many ways, especially in sports. But what I most remember at BLS was that he was a terrific friend to so many and a leader among them all. And for the next 45 years, that was a disturbing fact that I came across, but I said 45 years, good God. For the next 45 years that I've known him, he has always been much more Dorchester than Harvard. While attending Suffolk Law School, he clerked in my law office for 2 years, providing enormous assistance, mostly on criminal cases. He helped draft the First Circuit appeal of the denial of a writ of habeas corpus for a client, Bobby Joe Leister, who after 16 years in prison and 10 years of relentless appeal by a small team of lawyers, finally found freedom and justice, becoming one of the best-known examples of a wrongful conviction in Massachusetts. Jim's task was to write both a painfully suggestive identification procedure that was finally and recently addressed in Commonwealth versus Gomes when the SJC gave direction to prevent these kinds of due process of law horror stories. While his research was thorough, his writing clear and logical, what was most impressive was that for the dozens of hours he spent on this task, Jim refused any payment. When Jim graduated, he joined me as an associate counsel of Service Employees International Union, where he assisted me with the Court Officer Probation Officer Unit, which recently had been granted collective bargaining rights. I remained close to Jim as he migrated to the Suffolk County Sheriff's Office, Legal Office, and later when he started a two-man law firm in a small office in a strip mall in Dorchester, which evolved into one of the highest regarded litigation firms in the city. While Jim never appeared before me, his associates did, and I observed the excellent civil litigation product for which his firm is well known. As you counselors are so away. It takes a special strength to stand for election, to do as Teddy Roosevelt noted when he described how the credit belongs to the person who's actually in the arena. That experience of community service in and out of the political arena, I am certain, has shaped him more than any other. His record of addressing tough problems of urban life with skill, strength, compassion, and concern for his constituents is compels my confidence in his ability to promote a just society as only judges can. The district courts have enormous impact on the lives of so many who often have so little. Jim is a natural fit for the mission and goals of this department. He has the temperament, the empathy, the skill, the knowledge of the law that causes me to be very honored to recommend him for appointment. He shows his support.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next we'll hear from attorney Ralph Capro.
Good morning, Council. I first got to meet Jim Byrne back in 1983, and at that time he was running for elective office. He was running for district city council. He was on the other side of Dorchester, way down by the Milton border, and I was in Savin Hill. But we had mutual friends who reached out and asked me to get involved in the campaign. And I recall the first time I met him, I was so impressed with just his ease with people, the way he treated people with such respect and such courtesy. And I was also impressed by the fact that he had a fabulous memory. I probably didn't see him for another couple of weeks. We had talked, he remembered the names of my brothers, my family. He just had this gift. And he carried that gift into his law practice. I entered the DA's office, stayed there for about 4 years, and then I went to Liberty Mutual where I would work for the next 20 years. During the course of that time, I had the pleasure of having cases with Jim at the DIA in Boston, that's the Department of Industrial Accidents. It's kind of a unique place, as you may know, where everybody kind of knows everybody. And when Jim first showed up there, I was saying, geez, you know, I wonder if he's gonna make it here, because sometimes people come in and they don't quite fit, and it's a little bit unusual to get the hang of it. But I was pretty confident that he would figure it out, and the way he figured it out was, he asked questions, he learned quickly, and he treated everyone like he always had, with this great ease, this wonderful personality, and this courtesy that had always been his hallmark and trademark as an attorney. And then eventually, my career took me into the civil arena where, again, I would go up against Jim on many cases. And he was remarkable in the fact that he was always so well prepared. He was always so gracious to everybody in the room. When you would go for a judge, he was always prepared and gracious. But when he had a witness on examination at a deposition, he just knew how to depose witnesses. I would sit back and watch his great skill. He never went beyond the point where he had to go. He never tried to embarrass anyone. He tried to get the witness to the point in the case where the evidence was most favorable to his client. That was his job. And then he would shut it down. Because you see, for me, as I had known him for these years, he had always taken his ego out of it. It was not about him. What it was about was serving his client. And he knew, as a good lawyer, that if he pushed it too far, there was a chance that that witness would push the evidence back the other way. And he was able to take his ego completely out of it. And I respected that. And over the course of time, we developed a very nice friendship. We have been through many things together. And on a personal note, I've had some health issues over the years. And Jim's always been one of those people who, I didn't have anything going on with him in terms of a case, but he'd be on the phone, hey, Ralph, how you doing? Are you okay? And those kinds of little things you don't forget. I've been around this business for 34 years, and I don't think I've met anyone who has the unique combination of intelligence, compassion for people, ability to work hard, the desire to achieve the right result. All of these things combined in Jim Byrne, in my opinion, to make him a fantastic candidate for district court judgeship. He gets along with people. He's been in the trenches for so many years. He has been so dedicated to this profession. I am so confident that if this council approves him, he's going to be an outstanding district court judge. And I stand here before you, my experience, and say I don't think I've ever met anyone in the past 34 years that I can say was more qualified and do a better job. So I'm frankly honored that he's asked me to come forward and speak on his behalf. And I certainly hope that the governor's council sees fit to approve.
Thank you, Barry. Thank you very much for coming. Next, we'll hear from Jane Nastas, former office manager of law.
Good morning. I was hired by Jim Byrne in July 1984 as an administrative assistant in his law office. The law office was established 2 years earlier, and Jim was still in the process of building and expanding practice. In addition to meeting with clients, court appearances, and managing his cases in the law office, Jim was serving his first term at the Boston City Council, had recently become a first-time filer. Needless to say, his schedule was quite full when we first met. As busy as he was always approachable, friendly, and willing to take as much time as necessary to explain the situation or project. At a time when there were no computers or fax machines, and they never brought a pile of paperwork, there were many days and sometimes nights that Jim would just start taking up court documents, pleadings, making copies, answering the phones, doing whatever he could to make sure our deadlines were met. The law office is a general practice, and we had a full spectrum of clients. For many of our clients, this is their first interaction with the law office and the court system. They are often overwhelmed with their legal predicament or the legal process in general. As managing partner, Jim met with the majority of the new clients to evaluate their cases and help to guide them through the process. No matter the client or the situation, Jim would always patiently listen to the facts and what the client wanted to achieve. Sometimes there was nothing he could do, but sometimes what was done was not what the client wanted to hear. Jim would clearly outline what the strategy would be, the time involved, what was expected from the client, the cost involved, and the probable result. Some situations were extremely difficult if a death or serious injury was involved, or if the client was facing jail time. However, Jim was always sensitive to the client's emotions and spent as much time as necessary to clearly explain the legal process and answer their questions. Some prospective clients did not have the ability to pay, but Jim would discount or on occasion waive the fee. Many clients have several misconceptions regarding the legal process. Unlike television cases that take an hour to resolve, clients are shocked to hear what is involved in preparing the case, the length of time it takes to bring it to trial, and the fact that you don't always win. Clients are easily discouraged and upset when the cases drag on for years or a settlement offer does not meet their expectations. Jim spends many hours talking clients through their frustrations and answering their questions. He spends many additional hours preparing settlement demands, preparing for trial, compiling documents, speaking with expert witnesses, and preparing clients' testimony. There are some days when I've seen everything just fall apart. Even when the worst has happened, I have not seen Jim lose his composure. As anyone would, he gets frustrated, but he doesn't let that affect his ability to assess the situation and get back on track. He doesn't get rattled. As the firm grew, additional staff was added, technology advanced, additional employee benefits became commonplace, and 401 profit sharing were created. The introduction of computers, fax machines, and other electronic equipment required the implementation of a network and security safeguards to protect the private information of our clients. I worked with Jim on all of these issues and met with many professionals to discuss the options available to the firm. He has always seemed to find the time to thoroughly research the options being presented and was well prepared for all of our meetings. I worked closely with Jim on employee issues, budgeting issues, equipment purchases, advertising, tax issues, insurance issues, and client issues. I have spent thousands of hours with this man, and I've watched him interact with hundreds of people. I don't remember anyone who didn't like Jim. He has always made me feel that I worked with him, not for him. He has always valued my opinion. Even when we didn't agree, we always worked out our differences. I worked for Jim for over 30 years. I retired my full-time position in October 2014. Since that time, I have continued to work with Jim on several larger projects. Jim is obviously a well-educated and experienced attorney. He's not afraid to take on the challenge, and he's a man of his word. Most people appearing before the court as a plaintiff, defendant, or witness are stressed, anxious, and worried. Like many of the clients that Jim has worked with, this is their first experience with our court system. I know that Jim will, as always, be patient and fair. I could list many more attributes, however, I believe that anyone who appears before Jim will appreciate his kindness the most. I believe he'd be an outstanding addition to the Pride Club.
Thank you very much. Before, I just want to like to introduce Marilyn Petito.
I'm sorry I'm late, but I was bumper to bumper. I could have, I felt like just getting up and walking. It was so bad.
I did mention that to the folks here. I did this before I came to the press.
Thank you.
We've exhausted the list of the witnesses on your behalf. I do say a dear friend of mine, Mara Hennigan. If you'd like to say a few words, Mara is the clerk of the Superior Court criminal session. She's a former Boston City Councilor with Jim and my father. My father passed away in 1992, but I remember Mara and Jim. They both served. Good to see you, Mara.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My neighbor also served with your brother Richard on the City Council, and it's a pleasure to be here before you today. Councilors, it's a pleasure to be with you. Jim, it's great to see you. All the justices who are here supporting this wonderful candidate, and Jim's family who is here to support him. Although I have not seen Jim recently in a number of years, I had the great honor of serving with him on the Boston City Council. And not only did I serve with Jim, but we sat next to each other for the 10 years that he served on the council. And let me just say that Jim is a good, decent person. He is hardworking. He has an outstanding work ethic. He was loved by his constituents and was repeatedly re-elected year after year. In fact, sometimes I wonder, Jim, did anyone even run against you? I was never as fortunate, but Jim was really beloved and has the kind of work ethic that really a judge needs to have. Serving for the past 10 years as the elected clerk magistrate in the Suffolk Superior Court, I have quite a bit of interaction with the justices, and I know what it requires to be able to make the very important decisions that a judge is called on to make each and every day during his or her tenure. And I know Jim has that capability. He has the compassion, he has the good common sense, and most importantly, the work ethic. So it is my pleasure to be here to speak on his behalf today. I hope the council in its deliberations will approve his nomination. And I thank Governor Baker for putting this man's name, this very esteemed and good, decent man, forward for your consideration. Thank you very much for letting me speak today.
Thank you, and I've been here 32 years, and I don't think you've ever, at least I don't recall you appearing, so it must be...
This is my first time, and I don't take it lightly, so exactly. It's wonderful to be in this chamber. My former father-in-law, actually, Bob Casey, was a member of the Governor's Council, so I had been in this chamber never before to testify, so it's my pleasure to be here for you today, Jim.
Thank you.
Great to see you.
Thank you.
At this point, we'll hear from the nominee, Ms. Byrne. Before we hear from you, if you'd like to introduce your family,
certainly, Counselor. Scott, on the left, that's my daughter Deirdre, my wife Jacqueline, better known as Ginger, my son Brendan, we met Ralph and Jane, this is my youngest daughter Maggie, my brother Charlie, Judge Hughes. Judge Jackson, these a couple of the attorneys from my office, Peter Pashuko and John Cole. At your request, I've tried to cut this back.
We'll take a break halfway through.
Good morning, Councilor Ryan Allen and fellow counselors. My name is James E. Byrne, and I am the nominee for the Associate Justice of the Chelsea District Court. I would like to thank all the counselors for their time and courtesies regarding this hearing and for meeting and speaking with me prior to this hearing. I'd like to thank Governor Baker and Lieutenant Governor Colito for placing my name in nomination. I would also like to thank Lon Povich and Sharon Casey and her entire staff for all their help and guidance throughout this process. I'd like to thank my witnesses, Judge Christopher Muse, Judge Tom Drexler, James Masters, and Ralph Caparelli. For their kind words, taking time out of their busy days, I'd also like to thank my family and friends for their support. You already have my application materials, which outline my legal background. I've been asked to tell you a little bit about myself, so I'll begin at the beginning. I was born in 1954 in Dorchester, where I reside, as the second oldest of six children of Charles and Margaret Byrne. My mother was the daughter of Irish immigrants who grew up in in the Dudley Street area of Roxbury. In addition to being a mother of six and a homemaker, she maintained a career as a medical records technician working at various hospitals within the city of Boston Health and Hospital System. Sadly, we lost my mother this past year to Alzheimer's disease. She would have been 92 days. My father was born and raised in Dorchester. He's a World War II veteran. He became a patrolman and then a sergeant in the Boston Police Department. After many years in the Boston Police, he became a detective lieutenant inspector with the state police, investigating homicides and other major crimes out of the Middlesex and Norfolk County District Attorney's offices. My father was a wonderful man, kind, wise, giving, and just rock solid. He's looking forward to his 92nd birthday soon. I am thankful every day for the good fortune of having had my mother and father as parents. They were decent and honest, hardworking people who always unselfishly sacrificed for their children. Their character and dignity provided a wonderful example to their children, as they taught us the life lessons of hard work, honesty, responsibility, charity, and respect for others. I have been truly blessed to have had them in my life. I have one brother, Kevin, and four sisters. My parents had four children under the age of four, living in a flat in a 7-mill three-decker, and two of my siblings were afflicted during the polio epidemic. However, my parents pushed on and persevered, providing us with love and care and support. My brother and sisters have grown up to be wonderful, caring, and productive adults. My brother was an 18-year veteran of the Boston Police Department, having worked on the gang squad, the drug squad, and then as a sergeant. When he was required to retire after being shot with a 357 Magnum, along with a fellow officer in Dorchester during the early morning of New Year's Day, 2003. At the time of his retirement, Charlie had been awarded the George Hanna Award three times, the Schroeder Award, and the Boston Police Commissioner's Medal of Honor four times, as well as many other commendations. My sisters have also enjoyed successful careers in service to others. One is an oncology nurse, Dana Faba, one is an ER nurse at Boston Medical Center, another is a special needs teacher in the Boston Public Schools, and the youngest is a practicing attorney and now assistant clerk in the trial. I've also been deeply blessed with my loving wife and three children. My wife, former Jacqueline Conway from South Boston, is a beautiful woman in person who has walked with me through our life together as my best friend. She has been a devoted and caring wife to me and mother to our children. She has been an advisor, supporter, a confidant, a source of joy, a shoulder to lean upon, and the person who has always made our house a home. She was also graciously contented to be offered long hours and time away from home associated with being married to a practicing attorney in a small business. I love her and I cannot thank her enough. My son Brendan graduated from Harvard, having captained the varsity baseball team and having played as a member of the varsity hockey team. He works in finance in Boston and is a proud parent with his wife, Charlotte, two beautiful twin girls, age 15 months. My daughter, Deirdre, graduated from Tufts and received her PhD from UConn in psychology and works as a school psychologist at a charter school in Boston Public Schools. My youngest, Maggie, graduated with a degree in economics from Fordham University and now works in finance for Putnam. I have two kids. I love them and I am proud of them. After 8 years of parochial school in Dorchester, took the T every day to Boston Latin. After that, I attended college at Harvard. Both of those experiences were more rewarding academically. More importantly, they exposed me to people from all walks of life, all cultural, religious, socioeconomic, and political backgrounds, which I think has been a great lesson to me. I became the first person in my family to graduate from college and cherish my memories to this day of my times at Boston Latin. I then attended Suffolk Law School, where I benefited from strong legal training and from the challenge of working two or three jobs along the school. I worked as a law student in a small family practice, Muse and Muse, and then there as a first year attorney. In addition to gaining practical experience and insights, more importantly, I had the benefit of actively working on the Mortgage Lease case, observing and learning firsthand Bob Muse Sr. and his son Chris, a lesson on how an attorney's dedication, passion, and perseverance could have a life-altering impact on a client's life. As my first year as a first Sheriff's Department, Charles Street Jail. We are, in addition to working on collective bargaining agreements, procedures, and hearings and arbitrations, general liability issues, personal matters, and other department legal matters, I appeared almost daily in Suffolk Superior Court representing inmates at bail reduction hearings. But working at the Sheriff's Department, I was continually asked by people to handle legal matters. Because I was not in private practice, I could handle legal matters. After a year, I decided to go for it and on a shingle. I jumped into the world of private practice in 1982 with a partner in two-man operation of the Rochester Schoolfront. We didn't have a secretary, a copy machine, or even an electric typewriter, let alone a computer. And we certainly did not have an established client list. But we had some daring, we had hard work, perseverance, and vision. And each year, the practice grew, adding a great partner, Judge Drexler, and more attorneys and staff. Now, in our 36th year, with me being the constant principal during that entire time, we have generally employed between 12 and 20 employees and as many as 10 attorneys while maintaining our presence in Rochester. I am proud of the fact that as a small business owner, we have never missed a weekly payroll. Now, have we ever failed to pay a vendor or a bill, all the while providing our employees with health care insurance, 401k, profit sharing plans, life and disability insurance, annual bonuses, and other benefits. None of this could have happened without the effort and good work of the fine people who have worked with us over the years. I truly feel that having been a private practitioner running a small business gives me a real appreciation and perspective of what is involved every day in being a small firm. My personal practices include thousands of clients in various areas of the law. Initially, I did almost exclusively criminal law, serving as an appointed public defender from the list in several district courts across the juvenile court. Over time, my practice has evolved to a more civil-oriented practice with a focus on plaintiff personal injury cases involving matters ranging from wrongful death actions, construction site accidents, liability, farmers liability, and medical malpractice, to workers' comp, criminal vapor cases, I've also represented small businesses and corporations, insurance companies, liquor licensees, real estate developers, police officers, and firefighters, in transactional matters, administrative agency hearings, and litigation. I feel that my practice experience has been brought to me. In addition to my legal experience, I've served as a Boston City Council 5 terms and as the director of the Massachusetts Convention Center for Olympians. I've also been active in my community as a youth baseball and basketball coach, advisory board member, Rochester Project D, that's the Rochester Educational Enrichment Program, and as the director of the Rochester Boys and Girls Club and the Rochester Board of Trade. Serving as a judge is something I have contemplated doing during my career as an attorney. This position of great importance, responsibility in our judicial system and society. It is not an endeavor which I feel one should jump into without having the requisite experience, maturity, and seasoning. Having had a lengthy, productive career as an attorney in private practice, and having been a small business owner, elected public official, community volunteer, father, and grandfather, I feel that I can bring to this position and confirm the legal and life experiences, the patience and maturity, and the temperament and judgment to be a parent of the judge. Thank you, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much, Councilor Jumbo.
Thank you. Bye. Great.
A couple of things. As far as your background discussion with you, to me, yes, you have probably one of the best resumes that I've seen in the sense of being so well-rounded. me as an to me, it's a great district for a judge. It's not so much in the law, which you love. It's having a good dose of common sense. A couple of things that we talked about, and I'm going to ask you. There has been a push on by some judges to require lawyers to pick a jury trial, judge trials, at the time they file their brief, sometimes 2 or 3 months before the trial. So, fortunately, they're not in the majority. Doing is saying, well, you got to give up your right to the jury trial today. In fact, you won't know what judge you're getting. Some people say it's judge shopping. I disagree with that. Because the most you can find out about the schedule of the judge is not only a month. So 2 or 3 months down the road, I have no idea what's going to be sitting in that court. So for me as a defense lawyer, I refuse to sign that. Because not all judges are equal. Some never say the word not yet. Can't seem to get the nod out. So we had three Supreme Court nominees here. Every one of them said, in their opinion, it would be ineffective assistance of counsel if you gave up that right before you know what judge would say. So, I don't have any thoughts on it, but if you could just comment.
We discussed this. I don't think it's so much an issue with judge trials. Reference some judges that have a history of being for prosecution. It's a matter of knowing on the day of the trial who the judge is going to be. If you're marking yourself into the client in the process of the situation, you may have committed no practice. At least you entry of the charge against the person stays on. Unfortunately, some of these people go to the jobs and employers and they can give up the appropriate records to the employer. The employer sees somebody's been charged. Means nothing to do with any of this. You think the court of record should be like that? We always talk to the game about the presumption of innocence, the great law of the country. But when it comes to practice, we kind of hinder that by leaving things on court of records that are prejudicial. I don't even see a new record, but an employer would want to see it. You think they ought to change that maybe?
I do. That's been troublesome to me. I've seen that situation repeatedly for police unions, particularly possibly drone association. And this is pre employment, but in the doing background checks, these young people. On their further than the initial charge. And I've seen people lose their opportunities for a job because that becomes an issue with the hiring authority.
Well, I heard this. And I got to tag it.
Thank you very much, Councilor Harold and Petito.